Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to talk about the anterior compartment of the forearm. So, anterior forearm. Now, I am going to warn you, the forearm is complex. There are 8 whole muscles in this anterior compartment, and that doesn't even compare to the posterior compartment. And so we'll really focus on the big picture concepts regarding innervation, and we'll actually spend a considerable amount of time talking about actions. So strap in and let's get into it. So let's start with the super duper big picture. This compartment is called the anterior compartment of the forearm, but it is also called the flexor slash pronator compartment, which really gets at the main actions that can occur here. So flexion of the joints of the wrists and the digits, as well as pronation of the radio-ulnar joints. As a general rule, with of course a few exceptions, the more superficially placed the muscle is, this will have a greater effect on the more proximal joints, like the radiocarpal or wrist joints and the radial ulnar. So superficial muscles usually are these more superficial joints, whereas the deeper muscles will affect the more distal joints. So the ones out here in terms of, like, say, the interphalangeal joints. If I were to give you a bird's eye view regarding actions, as mentioned, think flexion of joints associated with the wrist and hand, and pronation of those radiocarpal joints, both those, the proximal and the distal radial ulnar joints. The median nerve is the predominant supply for this compartment. So I put 3 stars next to it. You know I'm serious here, but I do want to note that there is some contribution from the ulnar nerve. So a much smaller role, only in terms of 1.5 muscles. Okay, let's start to talk about these layers in a bit more detail, starting, as you might imagine, with the superficial layer. There are 4 muscles in the superficial layer. The first is the pronator teres, which is always the one I try to find in dissection first to help guide me in differentiating the others. You'll have the flexor carpi radialis, the palmaris longus, which we won't get into too much detail there, and the flexor carpi ulnaris. As you can see in this image, these muscles are more located on the medial side. So if I kind of outlined it here, they're really more on the medial side of the anterior portion of the arm. This lateral portion over here of the anterior side is actually occupied by the brachioradialis muscle, which is typically grouped in with the posterior compartment based on its innervation. So we'll talk about this muscle in another learning objective. So this arrangement trips people up. They try to make this muscle be an anterior compartment muscle, but this is brachioradialis. All 4 of these muscles in the superficial layer are going to have a proximal attachment on the medial epicondyle, which you can see here, and it can be palpated on the medial side of your elbow region. And the attachment of these muscles is through a common flexor tendon for all of these muscles. The actions of these muscles are more associated with the more proximal joints. As we mentioned, these are the superficial ones. And if you pay attention to the names, they tell you exactly what actions and what joints they can affect. So if you're looking at the flexor carpi radialis and flexor carpi ulnaris, these will flex the carpus or wrist region, so they'll flex the wrist or radiocarpal joint, just as its name would suggest. The pronator teres will pronate the radio ulnar joints, so pronator will pronate. So that kind of helps out right off the bat there. Additionally, the flexor carpi ulnaris, the flexor carpi radialis will abduct the wrist. So if you put your palm in anatomical position and move your hand away from the body, This is abduction or radial deviation of the hand via the wrist joint. Conversely, the flexor carpi ulnaris will adduct the wrist or bring it back towards the body. This is also known as ulnar deviation. All of these muscles are innervated by the median nerve except the flexor carpi ulnaris, which is innervated. I don't want to do that here. Here we go. Flexor carpi ulnaris is going to be innervated by the ulnar nerve. I always think it has ulnaris right there in its name, and it tells you what it is innervated by in this case. Moving to the intermediate layer, and this one is a bit easier to remember as there is only one muscle here, which sometimes you see lumped in with the superficial layer since it has a proximal attachment also on the medial epicondyle. And this is going to be the flexor digitorum superficialis, or the FDS. So this is a big muscle. The distal tendons, before I get into the distal tendons, I do want to note that I agree with the intermediate classification of the FDS, as its belly is definitely deep to the superficial layer. So you can see a little bit of it here, a little bit of it here, a little bit of it here, all deep to these tendons of the superficial layer. The distal tendons of the flexor digitorum superficialis are long tendons that traverse the carpal tunnel. So the carpal tunnel will be right around this region here. More to come on this, on the carpal tunnel in an upcoming learning objective. So the FDS tendons are going to traverse the carpal tunnel and will attach to the intermediate phalanges of digits 2 through 5. Meaning, it crosses all the joints on the way to its most distal joint crossed, the proximal interphalangeal joints, or the PIPs. And it is on these PIP joints of digits 2 through 5 that the most notable actions of the flexor digitorum superficialis occurs. So that will be flexion of the proximal interphalangeal joints, or the PIPs. But note, it can affect the actions of any of the joints it crosses along the way, playing a smaller role in flexion of, say, the wrist joint and the metacarpophalangeal joints of 2 through 5. The deep layer has a very similar muscle to the flexor digitorum superficialis, which is the flexor digitorum profundus. So you have the flexor digitorum profundus. So obviously we're looking at a deeper dissection here on this illustration. It also has 4 long tendons that will also traverse the carpal tunnel. So the carpal tunnel has been open in this particular illustration. And the flexor digitorum profundus tendons distally attach all the way on, the distal phalanges. So remember, these are the distal phalanges all the way at the end. So it will attach on the distal phalanges of 2 through 5. So it will cause flexion of those DIP joints. So remember, the DIP joints are between the intermediate phalanges and the distal phalanges. In fact, the flexor digitorum profundus muscle is the only muscle that can flex the DIP joints. Another muscle in this layer is the flexor pollicis longus. And this will be the first of many muscles that are solely affecting joints associated with the first digit or thumb, which makes sense that the thumb would have a lot of muscles associated with it due to its unique movements it's capable of. The flexor pollicis longus tendon actually also traverses the carpal tunnel. You can see it a little bit heading that way there. And it will distally attach to the distal phalanx, which you can't see too well here. It will attach all the way here in terms of the distal phalanx of digit 1. So it will cause flexion of the first interphalangeal joint. Remember that there's not a PIP or a DIP joint in the first digit, only an interphalangeal joint, as there is not an intermediate phalange in the first digit. Lastly, but not least, there is the pronator quadratus, which is actually the deepest muscle in this compartment. So it's even deeper than those that it shares the deep layer with. And the pronator quadratus is an exception to the rule, as this is a deep muscle actually affecting a more proximal joint. So it's going to be the prime mover for pronation of the radial ulnar joints. The pronator teres is more important for pronation that requires additional speed or power, but it's the quadratus that is doing the bulk of the work. Returning to the flexor digitorum profundus, it is unique in that it has innervation from two nerves. If I were to kind of split this muscle in half, its more lateral portion, or its more lateral half, is innervated by the median nerve, like most of the other muscles in the anterior compartment. And the medial half is going to be innervated by the ulnar nerve. All right, excellent. We have reached the summary slide. And as I mentioned at the beginning, this is certainly a bit denser of a learning objective and will likely take a little longer to fully digest all of this content. I would start with these generalizations for the whole compartment and kind of work out from there. So kind of adding in detail as you can. As always, as you are working through the material, feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues with questions. Thank you for your time and attention.